We're just going to start into our sermon series here. I'm so excited. Get your Bibles, take your Bibles and turn to 1 Corinthians, last chapter there in 1 Corinthians chapter 16. You ready? Here we go. Has anybody ever had a financial opportunity, you know, just come and in your life and you just kind of missed it? You know, there's just this great financial opportunity that you should have just invested in. Let me tell you about one. When I was in college back in the late 80s, I just told you how old I was. Back in the late 80s, I was in college and I was on a choir tour and I was staying with a host home, and this gentleman was telling me about this whole idea that he had. Now, I'm not saying that he asked me to actually invest in his idea, but he was looking for backers. And if I had money to invest in his idea, I tell you what, I should have, because I would be rich today. He was talking about, hey, Adam, I have this idea about these four turtles, and they actually talk, and they know like ninja moves. And I think it's really going to take the nation by storm. I'm going to call it, that's right, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. I kid you not, that actually happened. And I thought, when he was telling me about it, that is the stupidest idea I ever heard in my life. I wish if I would have been able to put two nickels together, I could have given him some money and I could actually have enough money in my savings account to feel secure. Isn't that a huge fear we have in our lives? It's one of the biggest fears in our lives, that we have enough money in our savings account to be able to live out the rest of our lives. We want to know, what's the number I have to hit financially? I have a great answer for this. I can tell you right now, all you have to do is make sure you die before your money runs out, right? I mean, if God blesses you with a long, long life, who wants that? I'm kidding. But we want to know, what is it that we can be secure in our lives financially? In today's culture, they start us out really young to be able to understand how we can make a financial investment in our life and make one that lasts. Maybe you've seen these E-Trade commercials. Remember these E-Trade commercials? Watch this one.
Oh, this is tragic, man. Investors just like you could lose tens of thousands of dollars on their 401k to hidden fees. Thankfully, E-Trade has low-cost investments and no hidden fees. But, you know, if you're still bent on blowing this fat stack of cash, there's a couple ways you could do it. Or just go to E-Trade and save it. Boom.
Boom. Anybody remember those commercials? No? I tell you what. Conventional wisdom says, hey, you have got to save your money. You have to make sure to plan for something that lasts for the rest of your life. You need to plan in order to be able to have enough money for your last day. That's the way conventional wisdom is. Kingdom wisdom, Jesus wisdom, is make sure you plan for the day after the day you die. Make sure you plan for the day after the day you die. In other words, when my earthly life is over and I enter into this time of eternity with God, how will I, and more importantly, how will God evaluate my financial life? I don't know. I think when people are on the other side of this life, I think when they go up to God, I don't think they're going to be looking at him and saying, you know what, I wish I had piled up more stuff. I think that people on the other side of death would say, you know what, I wish I had less anxiety and worry and less trouble over this whole idea of money. I wish I would have been more generous like my God has been generous to me. I wish I would have trusted in God more. I wish I would have expressed more financial generosity. My friends, I want to tell you, now is the time. Now is the time, because if you wait until you think that you can be more generous, this doesn't happen by accident. This is not something that you just fall into and now I'm more generous. This is something that actually takes practice. This is why we're in this series called Works in Progress, because we're not perfect. We're just trying to be better, and God is trying to make us better from the inside out so that we can live in His presence, in His care, in His kingdom, in His reality more and more in our lives. In the last chapter of Paul's first letter to the church at Corinth, this is what he says in 1 Corinthians 16, starting in verse 1. He says, "Now about the collection for the Lord's people, do what I told the Galatian churches to do. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income, saving it up so that when I come, no collections will have to be made. And then when I arrive, I'll give letters of instruction to the men you approve and send them with your gift to Jerusalem." Now, my friends, this is a really significant passage, and it's got a brand new idea to this ancient culture in where Paul was living at the time. And so much of the time, we just kind of glean over this. For anybody who is genuinely interested in learning what it means to be a generous person, you have come here for the right day. I want you to get a piece of paper out and a pencil, and I want you to write down these things. These are some observations about being a generous person. Number one, generous people believe giving is life's greatest investment. They believe that giving is life's greatest investment. Paul calls this a collection for the Lord's people. We read about this collection in a different areas in the New Testament. He's collecting money for some of the poor people who live in Jerusalem. There's a very significant thing going on here. I want to talk a little bit about it. There's something going on in the financial community that is just kind of mind-blowing. It's earth-shattering, and it's brand new. So many times, we just let this kind of fall to the wayside, and we don't really think about it. A little background. Jewish people and Gentile people, they were like oil and water. They did not get along. They were enemies for many, many, many years. And then there were these ancient prophecies that said one day they would come together. One example of this prophecy was this prophet Isaiah, who actually said these words way before the Apostle Paul ever came around. He said this in Isaiah chapter 2, "In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple," that's Jerusalem, "will be established as the highest of the mountains," that's the greatest, the most glorious, "and all the nations will stream to it." He says, "Many peoples will come and say, 'Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, and He will teach us His ways so that we may walk in His paths.'" Now, Paul is one of these guys that believes that these prophecies are going to come true, that the Gentiles, in fact, are going to be a people that one day worship Israel's God, and that these two communities will actually blend together into one. The problem is, how do we communicate this? He needs a concrete way to be able to make this happen. And he has this idea. He thinks, you know what, if I could get these Gentiles, most of whom, by the way, were very poor themselves, they were actually slaves, if he could get them to actually give money to these Jewish Christians in Jerusalem and have these Jewish Christians actually accept this money that they were given, well, that could really do the trick. I mean, imagine if that could happen. It was a crazy idea. Who could think this would ever work? It would be like McDonald's giving money, generous amount of money, to Burger King. It just doesn't make any sense. But it happened, and it worked. It was an economic miracle. It was like love, power, generosity that just knit these two communities together, and it made them gel. When Paul wrote to Corinth, this project didn't look like much. It was just a couple of scattered communities. He talked about the community of Galatia. You know, people thought, well, this isn't going to work at all. People thought, you know what, I'm going to put my money into Rome. I'm going to put my money into the Colosseum. And then 2,000 years later, what happened to the Colosseum? It's in ruins. Nobody's running for the Caesar office anymore. 2,000 years later, the church is still going and you can't stop it. When you're generous with God, you're investing in the only sure and certain project in history. Generous people believe giving is life's greatest investment. Secondly, generous people believe in God's faithfulness. They understand that God is faithful. When Paul's giving instruction about giving in the church, he says that in Corinth, they're to do this on a specific time. They're to do this on the first day of the week. Interestingly, he doesn't say do it every week. He doesn't say do it on the second day or do it on the third day. He doesn't say do it on the seventh day to make sure that you have enough money. He says do it on the first day. Listen, this phrase, on the first day, is a very significant phrase that everybody in the ancient world who heard that knew exactly what he was talking about. We tend to miss this, but it matters. In all four of the Gospels, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, this phrase, on the first day of the week, it gets used. On the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the Mary went up to the tomb. On the first day of the week, the tomb was empty. On the first day of the week, the angel said, "He is not here." On the first day of the week, death lost its victory and the grave lost its sting. And if you know a little bit about the scripture, you might know that in Israel, it was the seventh day, which was called the Sabbath, which was instituted as the day of worship and of rest. But after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, that special day got shifted to the first day of the week. And the reason for that shift is because it was resurrection day. The passage in 1 Corinthians is the first New Testament message of this whole significance of Sunday being the first day of the week, being Resurrection Day. This is huge. And the idea here is that we put the way we spend our money in the way that the Resurrection Day of Christ comes about, in the way we give, in the way we're generous. You could call it resurrection economics. Jesus said this, "Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds." Jesus gave his life away, and then he got it back tenfold in the resurrection, far better than in the resurrection. And the whole idea is the power of the death and the resurrection is the same way that we have the power in the way we can be generous financially. If you try to hoard your money and clasp onto your money, death will actually take your money. Guess who else will? The IRS. Paul wrote to Timothy, "For we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it." Your mom might have said that to you when you were young, but this came from Paul. There's this whole story of a dying man. He's on his deathbed. He wakes up, you know, from a slumber and he smells this beautiful aroma of chocolate chip cookies wafting down from the kitchen downstairs. And he decides, you know what? I have got to have one more chocolate chip cookie before I die. And so he painfully rolls over in his bed and he falls to the floor and he crawls out of his bedroom and goes down the stairs. He crawls into the kitchen and he reaches up over the counter and he clasps one of these beautiful chocolate chip cookies when all of a sudden he feels a spatula whack his hand. And he was shocked. And his wife says, "Put it back. That's for the funeral." See, if I clutch my money, if I hold on to my money with all that I have, death will always get it. The spatula is coming. But if I sow it like a seed, it feels like I'm losing it. If I just give it away, it just feels like it's going away. But actually, it'll bear fruit in many, many different ways. In fact, Paul says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. He says, remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Skipping down to verse 10. Now he, we're talking about God, who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. In other words, you can't outgive God. He just loves to give. He's in the business of blessing you. Jesus said these words, give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. The writer of Proverbs says, whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward them for what they have done. We remember this story of a little boy who gave his lunch to Jesus, the 5 loaves and 2 fish, and how Jesus used that little amount of food to be able to feed 5,000 plus people and later have 12 basketfuls left over. You ever wonder if they sent the leftovers home with the little boy? I mean, he deserves that, right? You imagine that? I mean, the mom says, you know what, son, we don't have a lot of food tonight. Did you have fun listening to Jesus today? Do you have any, did you bring over the leftovers? Mom, I think we need like a new refrigerator to hold all this stuff. I mean, you imagine how much food that is, 12 basketfuls of food? People who've expressed financial pressure or challenges, they know the blessings of God's faithfulness in their life. They understand this. I want to say something to all of you. I want you to know everything that happens here at Westgate is because of your generosity. All the caring for the students, all the caring for the children, the paying of our staff, the working with our missionaries. Your generosity makes all of that happen. Generous people believe in God's faithfulness. Thirdly, generous people don't wait until they feel moved to give. They don't wait. Paul said something really interesting when he wrote to Timothy about the reality of giving. Paul said to Timothy, command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and be generous and willing to share. He said, command those who are rich in this present world. Who is that? It's not me. I'm not rich. At least not yet. I mean, I got a phone call the other day. It's a true story. This guy called me. You know, apparently he knew me really well. He's been trying to reach me a number of times. It was this recorded message. And he just said, you know what? I've been trying to reach you, you know, and this is my last attempt. And I was really excited about that. He wanted me to be, involved in this refinance opportunity. And he said that I was pre-approved, not just approved. I was pre-approved. And it was really exciting. But then he said, you know what, you have 48 hours to be able to, you know, to reply back or else this whole thing is off. But in all reality, you guys, how often do we get bombarded in our culture to invest? How often do we get invited by our culture to spend and to buy and to consume? And to be honest, we're just a people that we're hungry to spend. One company actually made this estimate that at the end of 2018, credit card debt was an all-time high. You know what it is? $870 billion just in our nation. $870 billion in credit card debt. Overall debt in the U.S., $13.5 trillion. And that's not even including the government debt. But we're not rich, though. Paul says, command those who are rich in this present world. That's not me, of course. Is that you? There's this amazing pastor. You might have heard of him. Andy Stanley, he pastors this small little church. He talks about the power of deception in our financial lives. And he says this, denial makes me think I'm not rich even when I am. And denial makes me think I'm generous even when I'm not. Paul says on the first day of every week, resurrection day now, I'm trusting God. He says, each one of you, this is about everybody. It's not just for a select few. It's not just for those of us who think we have the money to be able to make the difference. It's for everybody. He says, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income. He doesn't say, wait until somebody or something gets you all worked up in order to give. In fact, notice Paul wants all this done before Paul even arrives because he doesn't want this emotional appeal to happen when he arrives. He wants it to be planned out and strategic. He wants it to have the people actually be able to learn what it means to be generous. Benjamin Franklin said this a couple hundred years ago. He actually wrote about this story, where he went to go see this famous preacher of his time, this preacher Whitfield. And Benjamin Franklin says that he had some coins in his pocket. He had some copper coins, some silver coins, some gold coins. And he decided ahead of time that when he went to see this preacher, he wasn't going to give anything. But Pastor Whitfield described this orphanage in a way that was so compelling that he decided to give some of his coins. And then he decided to give the silver coins. And then he said, I'm just going to give everything I have in my pocket. He writes about how this other guy was with him as a friend. And he had actually been to one of these Whitfield-like conferences. And he knew ahead of time how great this guy was. And he just said he left all of his money at home so it wouldn't even be a problem. The problem was, Whitfield was so good that this guy turned to the person next to him and said, can you give me a loan? I want to give to this project. I feel so compelled to give. Apparently, the man next to him was a Quaker. And he replied, at any other time, Fred Hopkins, I would lend to thee freely, but not now, for thee seems to be out of thy senses. Paul doesn't say give when you feel moved. He doesn't say give when you're out of your senses. He says, on the first day of the week, set it aside. On the first day of the week, set it aside. Build this practice in your life. Make it a rhythm in your life. We live in a great time where we have this amazing invention called bill pay, or we have auto pay in our day. You can make that happen in your life. If you want to be old school and like me and you use a checkbook, you can do that too. Make that check the first check that you write. First day of the week. If you practice giving regularly now, you will learn how to be a generous person later. If you just wait until you feel generous to give, there's a good chance it'll never happen. Because generous people don't wait until they feel moved to give. Number four, generous people don't wait until they have extra money, extra cash. Paul gives another instruction here. He says, on the first day of the week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income. He doesn't say, leave this to the wealthy few. Again, this is all about each one give. He says, each one give. And it was just mind-blowing. Again, we tend not to catch this today, but in the ancient world, the whole art of giving was actually something that was very prevalent. It was done by the rich, wealthy guys who would give this money. They'd give food and all this money to the poor. But there was a catch. The rich guys were called patrons. Patrons would give whatever they had, the money, the food, for them to receive it. And they would give the people who received it all this stuff. Those people were called the clients. Now, if you've heard me talk about the ancient world and Rome before, Rome is all about status. It's all about making yourself look good. So if you're a patron and you're giving to a client food and money, you would think, oh, that's really generous. No, What you're doing is you're putting a thumb on your client saying, you know what? You have to stay in a lower status from me until you can pay it back. This is true. This actually happened. Patrons would go into the city streets of Rome, and in front of them would be their clients, blowing trumpets in honor of their patrons. And these clients would always be in debt to the patrons. Giving happened in the ancient world. People saw it in Corinth like that. Giving had this kind of tainted view to it that you always had to pay it back. And now for the first time, giving is actually a community thing. Now the poor are no longer obligated to flatter the rich. Now everybody can give. Everybody has generosity. And everybody's generosity counts. Giving is an act of strength and dignity. Jesus saw this one time in this room where people were giving of their offering, and he saw this poor widow give these 2 cents, and he was like, she has given more in her generosity than anyone else in the room. In fact, in the Old Testament, the prophet Malachi is talking about the practice of tithing. Tithing, if you don't know, is giving the first tenth of what you have to the Lord. And he says something extraordinary. God says this. He says, test me in this. See if I won't throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing, there won't be enough room enough to store it. Of all of God's commands, all that he said in the Bible, God actually invites people to test him. He says, see if this won't be so. I dare you. See if I'm not being truthful here. My friends, generosity is the road to flourishing. This is just wisdom. And you can test God in this, even if you don't believe in God. A non-generous person thinks, I can't afford to give because I don't have enough. But when I have enough, then I'll give. Of course, the question is, how much is enough? And Paul says this, let each one set it aside. I was thinking about this very often in our church services. We'll say this at the offering time. We'll say, hey, if you're with us for the first time, we just want to extend this to you. You don't need to be a part of this great blessing and God's command to be generous. You just let that pass by. You know, it's kind of interesting. We don't say that about other wisdom in the Bible. We don't say, for example, the Bible says, thou shalt not commit adultery. But hey, you're here with us for the first time, and so don't worry about that one. Doesn't make any sense. There's something for everybody, even if you don't believe in God. God says, test me in this. See if I won't bless you. See if it's not true that you will become a generous person. And God will enhance your life in every way. Let's pray. God, I just want to lift up everybody in this room. And Lord, I lift up their hearts to you. I lift up the way that we are in the way that we hoard on to and clutch our money. I pray that if there's somebody in this room that maybe heard some words of wisdom from your word today, Lord, that you would touch their heart. Lord, we all want to be a generous people. We want to be more like you. We want to live in the reality of who you are and in your goodness and your graciousness. And we want to live each and every moment in your kingdom. And we can't continue to do the things that this world wants us to do. God, we want to be more like what you want us to do. So Lord, let your words just speak truth to us and let us be a generous people. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Everybody says together, amen. Would you stand with me? And in the moments that we have left together, you know, we've got a lot of neat things happening. We've got some people who are going to be baptized this morning. You know what? If you want to take a step of faith right now and just say, you know what? I want to be a man or a woman that God would be pleased with. You know, I've been living my life this way, and I want to live my life. I want to devote my relationships. I want to devote my finances. I want to devote my problems and my worries and my anxieties. I want to give those to Jesus right now because I can't control any of this stuff anymore. It doesn't work. I want to have a heart of generosity in every facet of my life. I want to invite you to come forward and just take a step of faith and just say, you know what, Adam, would you pray for me? I want to make a change. I'm here for you if you want to take this time and do that. And if you just want to go and just stay where you're at, that's totally fine too. I might come to you today. But if I do, just know I'm doing it out of love, and the Holy Spirit is telling me, pray for this person, pray for that person. I love you. Let's worship with this song, and let's just continue in our time together with the Lord.